Hi, Steve and Caleb from Brownells, and we're back with another episode of 5 Big Mistakes People Make When They're Building an AR-15. I thought we'd run out by this point, but I guess not.
You know, we've done 2 videos, 5 each, you know, with some, I think one had a bonus or two in it, so we're moving into some crazy territory now.
I think it's a testament to American ingenuity that, you know, we can still continue on like this.
Listen, American ingenuity, redneck ingenuity, whatever you want to call it, you guys have got it.
I'm guilty of all 3, and there's only 2 that you said.
Okay, let's move right into the first one here. That's gonna, and for the upper receiver, you know, I'll have a little thing here, upper receiver. And I have a barrel nut. Now, let's say for all intents and purposes here, there's a barrel in here, and we are torquing this bad boy down. Notice this one has teeth on it, so those teeth have to index for that gas tube to clear. Well, Steve, what happens if I'm building my AR-15 and my teeth, I torqued it where I want it, my teeth don't index, right? And my gas tube now is not going to fit, gas tube being this thing here, and you can see in this one, you can see in this one here that the gas tube has to go through those teeth to get to that upper receiver.
Right.
Whoa, hey, almost knocked your coffee over. That would have had to end the video right there. All right. So, let's say I'm a novice builder. I just did this. What are my choices here, Steve? What can I do?
Well, it's more a psychological problem than it is a gunsmithing problem. You see, the torque values are so wide. There's such a gap there between the minimum and the maximum that you can tighten that thing, that you can line it up properly.
Yeah.
But the first time builder tightens it up to that first space and he thinks, there's no way I'd like this. This is not tight enough.
Yeah. So, I mean, your torque range is on this steel barrel nut here is like 35 to 80 foot pounds.
Yeah.
You've got enough room there. If you've tightened it down on the high end, yeah, you've got room to back it off. When you back it off, come at the low end and torque that bad boy back down. So what we see here is people kind of get into a frustration in their mind.
Right.
What's the closest tool that cuts here? That's the Dremel tool. So let me get that Dremel tool out. That wheel will fit right perfect on that radius, and I can just remove that tooth, and that gas tube will go right through there.
Yeah.
I've seen that so many times, especially before the free float handguard barrel nuts that didn't have to index were a thing.
Uh-huh.
That's whenever you'd see a lot of this, because that's not just for this barrel. Other manufacturers make barrel nuts. And the worst part about it is, whenever they put handguards on that have to index on these slots here,
right,
like I think the old Samson ones did,
right,
for example. So if you grind that slot off and go to slide your handguard on, it's not going to index where it needs to. So now you have a handguard that's crooked.
Yeah, the gap tooth installation.
Wow, gap tooth installation.
And once in a while, the clever person will take that thing off to grind the tooth and get the wrong tooth.
Hey.
And you have to go back and get another one.
Listen, keep your teeth straight. You don't need dental work to get this to mount. You know, you don't have to go get your teeth worked on.
No.
All you need to do is just torque it to the right setting. Or worst case scenario, let's say you go through the torque ranges and you still can't get it. Use a shim. There's barrel nut shims out there.
Right.
And those work just fine. Those aren't going to, despite what you may have heard or read on the worldwide interwebs, those aren't going to hurt anything.
Right. And besides, the odds against that happening are really, really small.
Yeah. Yeah. Just don't do it.
The factories assemble thousands and thousands of these just first time with the barrel nut.
Yeah. Yep.
No shims, no nothing.
No shims, no nothing. Colt cranks them out like crazy for the military contracts and stuff. So,
never saw a shim in a Smith & Wesson or a Colt or a M&P 15 or a SIG, any of those.
Yeah, for sure. Next one, Steve.
There's more?
But wait, there's more. So having spare small parts on hand.
Yeah.
This is a big one, like especially, you know, as you build AR-15s, you accumulate some extra parts. But if it's your first time doing it, you're not going to have extra small parts on hand. And these small ones here, they can take flight. They can go missing when you're doing your thing, especially if you're on the kitchen table. You know, you're over here working on your AR-15 on one side of the table. Your wife comes in. She starts making whatever it is, some gumbo or something like that. Some sauce pecan, some jambalaya, you know, whatever your wife's cooking.
Tater tot casserole.
You know, whatever, to each his own. Whatever your wife's cooking. Next thing you know, you're missing some parts. And now you have detent spring gumbo, you know, it's in there. So,
man, when I need a detent, I just look on the floor in the studio here because it's littered with them.
Yeah, we got plenty. If you fall down on the floor, you're landing on a detent. Doesn't matter where you fall. There's plenty of them. I think there's some still entering orbit, coming back down.
Stuck to the ceiling.
Yeah, I can hear them coming down. There's meteor showers. Anyways, you can buy like these little, they're called oops kits with some spare parts in them.
Yeah.
And they're cheap. And just keep one of those on hand. Just all you need to do is have an extra one of those in your toolbox, whatever you're using as a tool, your lunchbox, like Ninja Turtle lunchbox, put your extra parts in. You can do that. That's a good thing to do. And
because if you don't lose a detent, your friend's going to when he builds his or whatever.
Yeah, or
somebody will.
Yeah, or like your friend lost a detent, so he's over here helping you with your build, and then when you weren't looking, he took your detent, stuck it in his pocket, because he's going to go home and finish his build, right? So now you're missing the detent. It's kind of like in the Army. Like, the thing everyone said was, like, nobody's stealing. Everyone's just trying to get their stuff back. So it's one of those types of situations.
Yeah.
All right, so I'm going to replicate an issue that someone commented on a previous video.
Okay.
And said that they've done this. So I'm going to replicate it and just see what the heck was going on in their mind here. So I'm gonna do it, and then I'm gonna show you, because you don't know what I'm doing yet.
I think I do.
Well, act surprised.
Okay.
Let me see if I remember how to put stuff together. There we go. Look at me go. All right. Screw this bad boy in here. Now, somebody mentioned they did this in the comment. How the heck did they do? I've never done this one myself. They put that castle nut on backwards.
I've seen that done.
And then, because like they, I understand the train of thought, because it's like it looks like you could stake it pretty good in that position.
You could stake it in any one of those slots, you know, by hitting the receiver. What am I trying to say?
Yeah, the end plate.
The end plate. Thank you.
You know that would actually work.
Yeah.
It'd be interesting to get a wrench on. You know, you'd have to use one of like those, you know what I'm talking about?
Rock River.
Yeah, one of those Rock River type ones. But you could make, listen, this isn't the way it goes, and I think it's kind of like blasphemous to do a forward control design castle nut that way, but it would technically work. Just because it works, it doesn't mean it's right, and we like to do things right.
And most of the castle nuts come with a little space for the staking, if you want to stake it.
Like this one. This one, actually, one of the things that's great about this forward control design castle nut is that it has a more pronounced one than other castle nuts.
It does.
So there's no reason to put this one on backwards at all. And let me get it off here, and I'll get you a close-up of that here. Just kind of show you, because I love these forward control castle nuts.
Remember, every time you screws that castle on or off, you have to take a drink.
Right there. Every time I do a shot, I just did this like 6 times. All right, so you can see that nice and easy there. So don't put your castle nut on backwards. All right, even though you may, of course, be tempted to.
It isn't wrong. We just don't do it.
It isn't wrong. We just don't do it. So the next two, Steve, are going to be related to something that could be a little dangerous.
Okay.
And that is your disconnector spring. So he already knows.
All
right, so here's your...
Springs look alike.
Here's your trigger. And let me see what kind of view we have of it in this bad boy right here. You can see the disconnector. So I'll put one together real quick here. With the box O parts. All right, so here's a disconnector. I'm gonna go ahead and grab one of these bolt catch springs because we're gonna be talking about that next.
Oh, good.
And a disconnector spring. All right, so notice, if you will, and I'll set it right there. This is a disconnector spring. Notice it is wider on the bottom than it is on the top. And that is for a reason, right? So if I were to take this guy and try to push it into my trigger where it goes, I would be met with some resistance. It doesn't want to go in. You have to force it down into there.
If you wind it the right way, it'll just go on in.
I just force it in.
Oh, okay.
Because I'm just
That's
so much...
That's just the way you are.
So much anger built up that I can just... All right. So that goes just like so. And whenever you have your disconnector on it, also like so, you know, it compresses. It can go down and up nice and free, right? No issue there. Now, the issue here, what people do that's wrong, is they'll put it upside down because they were met with resistance going
in.
It
goes in easier that way.
Yeah, so let's put it in upside down. Oh, yeah, that's nice and easy. Now, look at that. All right. So now let's put our disconnector on. Let's push this bad boy down. All right. Oh, look. Now our disconnector's stuck in the down position, Steve. So when we fire this gun, what's going to happen?
Well, one of two things.
All right, go for it.
Either nothing or everything's going to happen.
Nothing or everything. So whenever you shoot, the disconnector's not going to catch the hammer when it comes back down. So let me, I'll pull this off and show kind of that act happening. All right. So... we fire our gun. So in the firing process, our hammer comes back, and you can see it. The disconnector grabbed that hammer. So now it can't go forward, right? Until I let off that trigger, and then it sets on the sear. But if the disconnector never comes back up to catch that hammer, that hammer is going to keep going forward. It's going to follow the bolt.
Yep.
So, potentially, it could shoot, you could fire, it could double, it could triple, it could quadruple, it could dump the mag, depending on, you know, how everything's...
Or if it follows slow, nothing happens.
If it follows nice and slow, nothing will happen, it won't hit hard enough, and then you'll just get a failure to fire, which is the best case scenario, right? We don't want the gun to run away.
Well, we've all had that friend that took his disconnector out thinking he'd make his gun into a machine gun.
Yeah, yeah.
And nothing happened.
Well, the only thing different is the disconnector. I'll just take that out. That's not how it works. It's got a...
Then you've got a manual repeater.
Yeah, and that's no bueno. So, I mean, the moral of the story here is if you're going to make a machine gun, make a machine gun. Don't butcher a semi-auto, you know?
Now, I've had people put the bolt stop spring in for the disconnector.
That's our next one,
Steve. Oh, I'm sorry.
No, you nailed it. That's okay. So if you put the bolt stop spring where the disconnector goes, you're probably not going to have an issue.
No, it'll work pretty good.
It'll work just fine.
Yeah.
The only issue with that is that now you're going to take that that disconnector spring.
Because that's the only one left.
And you're going to shove it where your bolt stop goes, right? And it's a little bit too big for that hole, so it's not gonna spring. So your bolt stop's not going to work.
Yeah.
All right. So, yeah, that's a quick and easy one there, that last one.
But, oh, yeah.
Yeah, so be careful. Make sure you're putting a big bottom in first, you know what I'm saying? And then go from there.
Yeah, there's a lot of spring issues with AR-15s, you know? A lot of things can go wrong the first time.
Yes, absolutely. And, I mean, just pay attention to what you're doing. Just do it right. There's plenty of resources out there. We have a full AR build series that goes into every... little detail. I think I was wearing this exact shirt for most of it. So, I mean, it's not that matters at all, but it's just a fact.
No, it doesn't.
you're absolutely right. Nothing here matters. I don't know why that young kid's still talking over there.
All right.
That was my impression of you, by the way.
So, that about does it. So, if you have any more AR-15 big mistakes you can think of, please feel free to tap away at your keyboard and let us know in the comments. In the meantime, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.